Hello! In this video, I will show you how I make ink to do the ink paintings that I like to do. So, let's start off. These are Chinese paints, Chinese ink, Chinese brushes. I received this as a gift. You can see what it says. This is a perfect little container for the whole set, and I'll show you these tools. This is called an inkstone. There's a deeper part and a shallower part, if you can see that. The deeper part is where you store your extra water and extra ink, and the shallow part is where you actually grind ink. Grinding ink is what they call it, from what I've seen. Is the ink. And we have a little bit left. Black ink is made out, this type of ink, ink sticks, are an ancient technology, and they are made out of soot, animal glue, and sometimes herbs or other things like that to give it a nice smell, or a medicinal element. So one of the things that I found that's really important for making ink, a nice dark ink, is letting the ink stick soak, letting the tip of it stay in water for a little while. This is my water bottle. I'm gonna pour just a little bit. I like to pour a lot. I was told that this is too much. We'll do just a little bit. So what I like to do, and I already had a little piece of broken ink stick in there. I leave it in there just to soak. So as you could see, I let it stand in there. And we're going to do that for a little while. If you let it stand in there, it almost gets a little bit soft, and I find that the rest of the ink grinding process is much faster. And if I were to just you can hear that. That's just me very lightly going over the stone. It makes kind of a stone on stone sound. And I think it's much harder to make ink that way, and you use up a lot more of your ink stick. So we're going to let that sit for just a couple minutes, and while we do that, I'd like to show you the rest of the tools. So my little kit came with a tiny brush. So, but I also received a gift of a set of larger brushes, and it came in a box that looks like this. I received both of these sets from other people, so I don't actually know where to get it in person. You can buy this kind of stuff online, but looking for a place to buy this kind of stuff in person, that is a subject for another video. Anyway, so I can start from the beginning. These tools are ancient technology, initially developed in China, but also used throughout other East Asian countries, such as Japan and Korea. They are called the four treasures of the study, which is the inkstone, the ink, the brushes, and the paper. Paper is rice paper. We can get to that a little bit later. It's called rice paper or shuan. These brushes, but the important thing about this set is that it's the same tools that you would use for doing calligraphy or doing painting. And so, you know, in China, in old times, these were the tools to write with. So that's why it's called the four treasures of the study, because, you know, you have no writing without pen and ink. And these are sometimes called pens, and it makes sense once you realize that it's what you use for writing. But you use the same tools to make all the beautiful ink paintings that you've seen pictures of or maybe seen in real life. These brushes typically are made out of different animal hair. And so you have your, you know, your wolf's brush and things like that. You know, there are synthetic brushes, but I don't know much about them. All I know is the traditional is different animal brushes. Sometimes they'll have, like, one type on the outside and, like, a different type on the inside. These kinds of brushes are, they're different from Western brushes. Yeah, they're different. I don't know that much about Western brushes, but the main thing about these kinds of brushes is that they hold loads of water and ink. So, you know, one thing that I saw when I started, you know, learning about art was, oh, how to load your paintbrush, how to load your paintbrush. And I didn't understand. I was like, dip your paintbrush, then you paint. What's this loading business? But apparently, artists, you know, you have a brush and you have to fill it with your paint or ink or whatever until it's to a certain saturation, and that's called loading the brush. So these brushes can take a lot of ink, and that's really handy if you think about it for writing, because if you're writing a whole bunch, you don't want to be dipping back into that inkwell every 2 seconds. The better the brush is at holding ink, the less you have to dip it. So that's one of the differences. There's also different, you know, they do different things. They're for different purposes, aside from just being different sizes. They have different shapes on the end. They're made out of different materials, as I mentioned before. They're different in terms of, like, thicknesses and how they taper. This one's never been used. That's why it looks like that. That's how they look when they've never been used. I don't actually know the details. I'm probably using the wrong kind of brush. I need to learn more about that. Please forgive me. So we've covered, so the inkstone made out of actual stone, the stick, the brushes, the paper. I practice a lot on any kind of paper. This is fancy paper. This is the shuan. It's called rice paper, but my understanding is that it's more likely to be made out of paper mulberry. There are a lot of different materials that this kind of paper, that the paper is made out of. This is a scrap drawing, so I'm going to be using it as test paper. It rips really easily. Like, it's very, very delicate. It crinkles really easily. It came in a roll online. It wasn't very expensive. I got it from a website that, you know, specializes in Chinese art supplies. But, you know, this is like for your nice projects. I practiced a lot on just normal paper. So I think we can try. So when I first started doing this, you know, I received this as a gift from someone who received it from someone else, and they didn't really know how to use it either. And so I had to figure out myself how to take a rock, another rock in effect, and water, just plain water, and make ink. And, like, I was seeing stuff online about, like, oh, you gotta grind it. You gotta really, really grind it. And I was like, what does that mean? And I was getting really inconsistent results. I was trying to do it, like, really lightly. And then I'd go and check, and it was, like, white. It was, like, nearly gray. I don't want that. I want dark. It's ink. But that's one of the cool things about, making ink this way, because, you know, you can buy pre-bottled ink and dilute it and whatnot, but one of the cool things about doing it this way is that you can customize how dark you want it, how light you want it, and like if it comes out too dark, you can add water. If it, you know, you can pour water off if you've got too much water, and then do this. So what I'm doing right now is basically just like brushing. I'm brushing very, very lightly across it, and it feels kind of smooth. Like I'm really not pressing into it at all. And I think because it feels like smooth when I move across it. It doesn't feel like hard. So like I could, like that's really hard. I don't like how that feels. I feel like I'm hurting the stone. You know, these are like your tools. You have to treat them nicely. You're not going to get good results if you are like trying to squeeze your tools to get what you want out of them, despite their protestations. I had to figure that out. At first I was just like abusing it, and then I looked at my brushes and they were all torn up, and my stone had all these like little pockmarks in it, and I'd like, you know, used up most of an ink stick with like very little to show for it. And I was like, what am I doing? My tools look beat up, tired, and exhausted. Like, I need to be taking better care of my tools. Like, yeah, there isn't really a store I can go to buy new stuff. I'd have to order it online. So I think that actually we should have a nice dark color at this point. I don't know if you can see it reflected in the camera at all. It can be hard to tell, especially to tell the difference between like clear water and ink, like dark water that's been mixed. Let's try it. Forgot which brush I like to use. So there are different techniques for loading the brush. If you want, they call it like a dry effect. I can show you what dry effect looks like. Like that. That's called dry. It's good for many different things. Textures, hair, mountains, all kinds of stuff. But I kind of feel bad using the brush for it. I'm like, oh, poor brush. It must hurt. So I have like dirty water. I like to get this wet first. Get it wet. And then I like to get like almost, like most of the liquid out of it. If you can see how I'm doing that. But I do like it kind of moist. And when you're first starting out, like your session, like your brush is going to be dry, so it's like, it's going to pick up, it's going to take some time for it to get wet, and like by the end of your painting time, your brush will be like really, really wet, and you don't have to dip it in like your water as much, because, so with every stroke that you make, you will lose a little bit of ink and a little bit of water in your brush. So you can start out, you know, before you refill your brush, you start out being able to make like really juicy wet strokes, and then by the end of it you're making really dry strokes like these. So it's kind of fun because you get to like plan which parts of the painting you want to make based on how much ink you have in your brush. So I didn't do a whole, you know, I had very little liquid in here actually. So you can go against the edge of the brush to let get some of the liquid out. And actually I've heard this recommended to make sure that when you're loading the brush that all that ink gets into the middle, because when you do it like this it kind of flattens out and pushes ink to the middle. You might notice this is a brush that like turns this kind of shape,
and it's meant to do that. Okay, it's meant to do this. Okay, well, I got everything that's in there, and we'll have a semi-dry effect. And so how do you know when your brush is full? It's when you put it in your ink and it can't pick up anymore. Like, you'll wave it around and, like, there's the exact same amount of ink left in the well as there was before you put the brush in. And that's how you, and also when you go against the edge and, like, nothing really comes out, right? Like, there isn't really any liquid coming out. That's kind of how you know it's full. And you can get depending on how wet of an effect you want or how dry of an effect you want, just through experience, you can figure out, you know, when the brush is able to do what you want it to do. So we're just going to try this out. Why not? So again, as you remember, this is the brush that that could go like this. So as you could see, this part was actually very loaded, wet, and dark, but the tip of it was actually almost completely dry. Oh, there's something in it. There's something in the tip. But when I was doing this, this is how you do the bamboo shape. Maybe I wasn't pressing enough. No, it just doesn't want to do that. So now, I mean, at this point, what I would normally do is reload. But if you have a painting that calls for some strokes like this, now is the time to do them. Since this is the beginning of the painting, I'm actually going to put this back in here. This is the end of the basic process, so if you feel like you got a sense for it, you can turn the video off now. I'm going to make another batch just to show what the second batch looks like for anyone who wants to stick around and keep and see another example, basically. So I basically just mixed one batch of ink, and now it's time to mix another one to continue the painting. Let's do it again. There's my little piece. I had another little piece that broke off, and I was like, what do I do with it? What do I do with it? It's too tiny for me to hold on to it any longer. And so I was like, I'm just going to leave it in there. And eventually it did melt. I mean, it just, you know, it became part of the liquid. And it got used up. And, you know, they get kind of soft, and so you can, like, kind of squish them. Oh, no. I'm going to gather up that little bit. Actually, I'm going to use a different brush. I'm going to get this. Let this sit for a second. Now it's been... used and we let it soak. You know, I've seen videos that say that you should let it soak for 5 minutes at least before starting. You know, it depends. 5 minutes is probably better. What I'm doing is just wetting this other brush. And sometimes I even use this dirty water as like a light gray in Western art. You might call that a wash. A wash is when you like do the whole background. That's called a wash. When you paint the background all like in one color or just fill it in general. I've seen it used mostly in watercolors. They'll say, I'll start out the watercolor with a light purple wash. That's okay for now. Round two. My friend who is from Hong Kong, she told me that they had to learn how to... you know, they used pen and ink in elementary school to write Chinese characters. Thought that was really cool. I have this idea in my mind that, like, if you grow up with writing, like something so core as writing, being associated with a brush and ink, that maybe it makes you, like, the jump to start painting is smaller. The two go hand in hand, really, especially because paintings often have words on them. You know, the title, other kinds of information. So it took me a really, really, as I mentioned before, it took me a really long time to figure out how to do the grinding in a way where, like, sometimes I would get chunks, and but I'm kind of just, I don't know how to explain it, I'm gliding across. I want it to be kind of smooth. There's some roughness, though. I can hear it. Sometimes you'll hear, like, the actual, like, grinding sound, but I decided I don't like that sound. And I prefer when I can have something smooth. But, you know, you can just let it sit in there, and some of it will kind of, like, ink. The ink will dissipate into the water around it just from it sitting there. And you can kind of just, like, you know, shake it in the water, and some of it will come out. And what you can do is you bring the liquid up from the deep part into the shallow part, and up here you can mix. There are people who are like, oh, you shouldn't put your ink stick in the deep part at all. The deep part is all clean water, and you only do it up here and all that stuff. And you only go in, like, a teeny bit to, like, bring the water up. If you don't see how I'm bringing the water up, I push it a little bit, and it stays up here. Not much, but it stays. You're supposed to... Well, my friend from Hong Kong, who I mentioned before, she told me that her grandpa told her when he was teaching her how to do this, that you're supposed to meditate when you're grinding it. I've read that too. You can think about what you want to paint using your ancient tools. Getting a little grindy. Okay, I'm gonna see how dark it is. I've read books that are like, oh, you should know exactly how dark it is when you're mixing it, and, like, you should be able to, like, mix three different colors of gray perfectly before you even start painting. And I'm like, man, if I had to do that, I would never have painted anything. Just go with what I get. And you can always adjust. That's the amazing thing. So another thing that is, like, you can just get, like, a little bit on the tip, or you can really go in and, like, get the whole side of the brush. Get it in there and pick up ink that way from the side. And you can get different effects that way, right? And also, like, so you can see, what does it mean when it's full? So see when I'm, like, I'm, like, putting my brush in it, but it's staying there. And when I go against the side, there's a little bit that comes out. This is the first time I'm using this brush in this session, so I'm gonna do this for a minute. I like to really get in there, get real, especially in the beginning. This may be, like, totally making some people who actually know what they're doing being like, ah, ah. I don't care. The city is about how I do it. I do care, actually. I care a lot. I wish I had a teacher. But Uncle YouTube is my teacher. I've seen funny brushes online. I've seen videos for people who are like, I made a brush with my dog's hair. Man, that was nasty. I also saw a video of someone, this was a real brush that they got online, using a rooster feather brush. And there's all, like, you can get any kind of animal brush out there. It's kind of gross. It's, like, very unvegan. You know, rat whisker brush and, like, boar skin brush. I've seen bear brush. Of course, you can probably feel like a boss if you're like, yeah, that is my bear brush. My bear brush. This painting was done with bear brush only. I'm gonna try and do a leaf. So this is what we get. I would say it's not I don't really have much to say about it except that you saw from when I started how I mixed it to this point. This is the outcome that I get. So it's actually a little watery in this area. You can see it's kind of bleeding out from the stroke. And then down here, on the tips, it's the broken effect. So, not ideal, and also it's broken on this edge. You can start to see it, how it gets broken right there. The bottom was alright, and the beginning stroke was okay, except for, you know, the fact that it's too watery. Let's get some more ink. I find that the most uneven results happen in the beginning when you're first loading a brush from being dry. And, you know, a brush that's like been well loaded is, it's like you've done this process of like loading it and painting like a few times to where it's like thoroughly wet. And then you can have like a really nice even stroke. Let's see what we have now. Oh yeah, look how much nicer that is. You can compare. It's the same stroke. Oh yeah. That's much better. I also did it faster, which gave it less time. I made the stroke faster, which gave it less time to bleed. And as per usual, my finish is sloppy, no follow through, did a bad job, Jim, never had good follow through. You can see how much ink is in here and how dark it is, so I just made like all these strokes without refilling the brush at all. And this, you know, this is just like scrap paper that's already been used on the other side, so it's kind of the paper itself is kind of crumpled, and that's why you get ugly effects like that when your paper's crumpled. So the next stroke I made after those five is already much, much drier on the tip from what you can see. I'm trying to do it nicely. This came out very, very dark with a lot of ink in it. That's what you get if you, like, go along the side. Also, if you want to make your bamboo stems. Oh, that's nasty. The brush is still very, very dry. As you can see. Well, I did paint all those other strokes. I'm going to finish this little last bit, get the last bit in here of ink that we made. I'm going to use it up, and then we'll finish the video. I think I have a tendency to prefer more wet brushes than dry. Because with dry, you just get uneven. I mean, most of the time I've been trying to paint bamboo,